ओम नमो भगवते वैवस्वताय मृत्युवे ब्रह्म विद्याचार्याय नचिकेतसे च ओम सहनावतु एतद्येवाक्षरं ब्रह्म एतद्येवाक्षरं परम् एतद्येवाक्षरं ज्ञात्वा यो यदिच्छसि तस्य तत् सो वी हैव सीन दिस बट वी आर गोइंग टू सी इट इन अ लिटिल मोर डिटेल आई गेव अ लॉन्ग इंट्रोडक्शन फॉर दिस रीजन ओनली एतद् हि एव एतत् हि एतत् प्लस हि बिकम्स एतद्धि You know, and then you add eva, etadhyeva. Yeah, so lots of sandhis. One of them is a funny one called jayoho anyatarasyam. Yeah, Paninian Sutra. Anyway, so etadhi eva aksharam brahma. So this aksharam brahma here means the indeclinable. That which is everything. Etadhi eva. Here it means Ishvara. Sagunam Brahma. You know, this is what it is. Etadhi eva aksharam Brahma. Aksharam means that unchanging. Even though the creation changes, that Ishvara which is sustaining the creation doesn't change. In that sense, in declining, unchanging, all those meanings we have seen in the Mundaka Upanishad of the word Akshara. So then, this is Brahman. Okay. And this Om is what is Brahman. All right. Etadhi eva param. Etadhi eva aksharam. You know, Brahma. Etadhi eva aksharam Brahma. Etadhi eva aksharam param. Now there is two aksharas. How many Brahmans? Then why there are two aksharas? If akshara is Brahma, then it should have just been used once, but there are two aksharas. What is this two Brahmans? No. One is maya upadhi avachinna as it were, you know, Brahma, which is that Brahman which is having the upadhi of along with maya. That Brahman which comes along with maya, maya is who? The shakti of Brahman, visualized as the goddess, as the feminine aspect which gives Brahman the power to create. In other words, Ishvara. Because Ishvara, whenever we say Ishvara, Ishvari comes along. Yeah, for free. You know. In fact, this maya which is Ishvari, herself is responsible for giving Brahman the title of Ishvara. Yeah. So this is understood. When you say Ishvara, it is definitely understood. You know. Just like the word she includes he. Correct? Yeah. That's why. This is exactly how it is. So when you say Ishvara, that the feminine force is already there. In fact, it is that's what is sustaining everything, including this. So then there is aksharam param. What is this aksharam param? Here we are talking of the force which is the Atma, the presence, the sentient and limitless presence without the impulse or the desire or the shakti to create. Knowledge is there. This is what is param. And param you cannot talk about param without talking about yourself. Why? That param is you. That param is you. That param first has to include the self. Nay, it is the self. That is the understanding. So then, here in this verse, it's like that joke that Pujya Swamiji used to tell. I don't know if he doesn't do it nowadays, but long time ago he used to have this joke. You know, he would be going in the train. People are going in the train, etc. You know, it's an all night long train. Morning is just breaking on the train, and everybody is in various stages of stupor in their seat. And then suddenly they hear a voice, and everybody says, "Coffee, coffee." He will give from the same kettle. And another person just is, that fellow is waking up, and he says, "What? Tea, tea." He gives the same thing, correct? So the same Om is like that kettle, that mysterious kettle, which no one knows whether it contains coffee or tea. It's what everyone wants. That's what this whole thing is. It's exactly what everyone wants, because it's got a sound. It ends E. Om Ishvara. Om. Om myself. Om. Om Jagat. Om. Om Karta of the Jagat. Jagat Karta. Jagat Karanam Brahma. Om. Om Pratika. As soon as I think of Om, I think of Ishvara. Om. Om Alambana, meaning I use that to meditate upon Ishvara. Om Namah Shivaya, Om Namah Shivaya, Om. And then Om Jnanam, Om, same Om. It lends itself to various uses and nobody seems to know what it is all about. So mysterious, like the contents of this early morning and extremely adept salesperson on the train. With a kettle, you know. So like this, here, etadhi, this alone is what? Aksharam Brahma, coffee. This alone is Ishvara. And here it is what? Used as pratika, meaning it is a word that has a meaning of Ishvara. Etadhi eva aksharam param. This is indeed the alambana and the jnanam of that which is the ultimate end of the human being, which is really you. This is what it is. Oh, that's nice. And then what? The second one, Aksharam Param, means that it is something beyond just the creative power of Ishvara. Meaning, it is that presence which sustains everything and into which everything resolves, it alone remains. And at that point, you cannot call it cause. Why? Mm-hmm. Because? Because there is no effect. No, adhishthana is because when there is something there. Adhishthana is when there is something to refuge, when there is something to hold. There is no adhishthana. There is no adhishthana. There is no jagat karanam. There is no cause. There is nothing except you. Oh. Kind of lonely. That's why take it as pratika, take it as shabda vachya, take it as alambana first. Before you get to this place of seeing that I am everything, this is what is sarvatma bhava. This is what the whole thing is explained. And then the first quarter of the first line, which is that etadhi eva aksharam brahma, sagunam brahma. And also pratika. Pratikopasana, using the Om as a pratika, as something that is standing for Ishvara. Om is one more name for Ishvara. This is how, at the very lay level, this is how we take it. Second quarter of the mantra, etadhi eva aksharam param, Om as, you know, a certain, slightly, you know, Om as nirgunam brahma, Brahman which is Swarupa, Swarupa Lakshana of Brahma. The first one is what? Tatastha Lakshana. Tatastate Tishthati Iti Tatasthaha. Swarupa Lakshana in the second instance. And in this Swarupa Lakshana, what is there? You know, you. Because Brahman Swarupa is your own Swarupa. Oh, really? Yes, really. So therefore, so second quarter is Swarupa Lakshana, first quarter is Tathastha Lakshana, first quarter in other words is Ishvara, second quarter is Brahman without the Jagat, which is you, Brahman's Swarupa, the real nature of Brahman, which is Satyam Jnanam Anantam. So the second one is referring to Satyam Jnanam Anantam Satchidananda. And then the third quarter, Etadhyevaksharam Jnatva. Knowing this akshara as what? Yourself. That is the... It's not enough to know that there is something called nirguna. It's not enough to know. And some people ask a question. You like sagun or you like nirgun? People ask. As though it is like, you know, you like chips or you prefer papad. You know, papad is this, what is that? You know that, no? Crunchy. Yeah. You like chips or you like papad? Papadam? What do you like? This is not, you know, this is not something about what you like. Do you know what this means? No, I only worship sagun. One person says, meaning, gunaihi saha vartate, that which is with attributes. Does Ishvara have attributes? Yes.
Yes.
Jagat karta, jagat dharta, jagat samharta. All these are attributes of Ishvara, functions, forms, names. All these are there. So do you want Ishvara with attributes or Ishvara without attributes? I mean, is it like a salad with dressing or without dressing? What is this? You know? If something is with attributes, then, you know, like Ishvara, then it can be objectified, correct? Mm-hmm. Yeah, to a certain extent, you can say that which is the cause of this universe and unto whom all my prayers are, you know, given. And this is Shiva, this is Vishnu, this is so many forms and functions. There is to a certain level, there is an objectification because you cannot avoid that if you are using it as an altar of the surrender. You are the subject and that is subject to your, you know, devotion. That is the object of your devotion. Correct? And then in the other instance, when it is Param Brahma, when it is Param, when you talk of Param, it's Nirguna. And some people say, I want to worship the Nirguna. How are you going to worship Nirguna? Huh? How? No, all this saguna is for, you know, KG spirituality. You know, those people who are in spiritual KG. Yeah. A for Atma, B for Brahman, C for Chit, D for Dhyanam. This is for their, you know, just basic vocabulary. They're just not even familiar with the verbiage. It's for them. I have gone beyond Saguna. I only worship Nirguna. How? How? Oh, Nirgun, please come. You who are beyond the gunas, you are already, you know, we are making a contradiction there. And so therefore the third line says that the only way to connect with this Param, which was talked about in the second quarter, second pada of the first line, is through knowledge. Etadhi eva aksharam. And here this aksharam can mean either this one or that one. You know, etadhi gnyatva. You can also add in brackets dhyatva for some people who are not able to do jnanam, who are not able to understand. So jnatva means having gained the knowledge of, having gained the knowledge of this akshara as jagat karanam brahma or as that which is free of all attributes, which is the truth of yourself. Either way, having gained this knowledge, yaha yad icchasi tasya tat. Yaha yad icchati tasya tat. Whoever wants whatever, whichever of these two, will gain that. It's again not like, do you want salad with dressing or without dressing? Without dressing, you know, naked salad, nirgun brahma, nirgunam brahma. Salad with dressing, Ishvara, you know. with the oily and sour jagat. This is the whole thing. You know, this is not like what you want. It's not about what you want. It's where the person's adhikaritvam lies. What are you capable of understanding? What are you just capable of even, you know, bending your mind around this? Or do you need to meditate some more? Or do you need to just use this as something, as an object of devotion before getting to the next place? Because the antahkarana shuddhi is not there. This is explained in the Bhashya very well. So let us see that. So it's not about choice. It's about what one is capable of. Etadhyevaksharam Brahma Aparam. Yeah, so immediately he says the first quarter of the mantra, he repeats Etadhyevaksharam Brahma. He immediately says Aparam. No, nothing more. This much you must understand. Aparam means what? Ishwar. Oh, no sound here. Okay. Again, we have no sound. All right. Just connect my audio. Sound will come. Okay.
It was coming.
No, it was not coming. Volume also we'll check just to make sure. Yeah, it's gone to middle again. You have to put it on high. And you have to do one more thing. Select microphone, that's all right. Yeah, now you have sound. The other place had sound, no? Yeah. Okay, now you have sound from surround sound. Yeah. Okay. So, etadhi eva aksharam brahma. So, this is aparam, he says. Aparam means what? Ishvara. Etadhyevaksharam param cha. He just adds cha. He doesn't explain this much. Cha means it's the same word. Etad here, let's not forget, refers to?
Om.
So Om is the one that is Brahman. Correct?
Mm-hmm.
Which Brahman? Ishvara. And Om is also, cha is the whole Ishvara, Swarupa of Ishvara as well, where the Jagat does not come in, which is my own Swarupa also. That is what is being said in the first line of the Bhashya. Tayoho hi pratikam etadaksharam. Yeah. Tayoho hi. Tayoho means of those two, pratikam etadaksharam. This Omkara is the indicative of both of these. Both of these what? Both of these aspects or manifestations of the Atma. The Atma along with the Jagat called Ishvara, and then Ishvara without the Jagat, which is the truth of the Atma, which is the Satyam Jnanam Anantam Swarupa of the Atma. Etadhyevaksharam Jnatva Upasya Brahma Iti Yoyadichati Param Aparamba Tasya Tadbhavati. Yeah, he is not thinking much of this verse. Because he's already explained earlier, and so he's just, you know, going to good timing. So he's just going to talk about this. There's not much to explain. What he says is that etadhi eva aksharam, third quarter, first line, third quarter of the mantra, etadhi eva aksharam gyatva. So gyatva he is changed into Upasya. Upasya means having meditated upon. He's either changed it into that, or he's saying Gyatva and Upasya. Both can be, both ways we can take it. So knowing and meditating upon, and having meditated upon, depending upon what? One's own capacity in terms of adhikaritvam, what one is capable of. Yaha yad ichchati param aparam va. Whatever one ichchati here doesn't mean desire. Ichchati means the one, whatever one is capable of gaining, one gains that. How do you gain param brahma? Through upasana. You can't. So how do you gain param brahma? You know, how do you gain aparam brahma through upasana? What will happen? You go to brahma loka. That is what is the phala, you know, of omkara upasana without knowledge. This is what the phala is, that you go and sit in brahma loka. And then, you know, talk about other people who didn't make it. And that is what you'll do. What else to do in brahma loka? Brahma loka. And Brahmaji will pick up Kathopanishad, and this verse will only be going on when you enter there, sitting on cloud number 9. And this is what will happen. So therefore, better learn here itself. So here, he says, paramva, aparamva, whatever the person is capable of, tasya tad bhavati, that thing comes to them, either in the form of a loka or in a form of a upasana phalam or jnana phalam. Jnana phalam is moksha. Fruit of knowledge is what? Moksha. Moksha is what? You know, freedom from all kinds of notions of afflictions, fears, sorrows, etc. Param chet. Jnatavyam. Aparam chet. Praptavyam. Somewhere else it's also dhyatavyam. Yeah. So he makes a very, this is why he doesn't go into detail, because he ends it with a bang. What does he say? His famous line. Param chet. If we are talking of the ultimate, if we are talking about Om as you, then what? It is something to be known. It's not something to be repeated. It's not vachya, it's not pratika. Oh, om means me, oh good, that's nice. No. And it's not alambana, I'll just keep on saying om until I know I'm om. No, that's not going to work. It is something that needs to be understood. Param chet jnatavyam. Aparam chet praptavyam. It is apara, it is not para, you are para. You are the ultimate. But if it is other than you, which is even Bhagavan, it has to be reached, praptavyam. You have to gain the grace in order to gain this knowledge. That's all we can say. So both, that's why this verse includes everything. Whatever one wants. If one is at the level of repeating Om to gain a certain bhakti, shraddha, and prepare for the jnanam, same. Wonderful. And if one wants to take the help of Om to have a quietened mind, okay. If one wants to just glorify Ishvara using the word Om, in the Sahasranama you say Om 1008 times. Wonderful. Yo yadichyati. Whatever one is capable of, tasya tad bhavati, that's what they get. But if one is ready to go a step further, Om is jnanam of you. Om is self-knowledge. Om is the highest embodiment of and the depiction of self-knowledge. In the shortest syllable, if you want to say self-knowledge, you say Om. That's what you say. So that's what, you know, Bhashya is small here, because it's very clear. It's not, you know, especially after that long background we have done, we have been honing into this for a long time. Next one.
Etadalambanam shreshtam.
Etadalambanam shreshtam.
Etadalambanam param.
Etadalambanam param.
Etadalambanam jnatva.
Etadalambanam jnatva.
Brahmaloke mahiyate.
Brahmaloke mahiyate.
Yeah. So now first we saw as pratika and vachya in the and also jnanam in 16. Here it is seen as, you know, when here Om is seen as a as both an aid for gaining for meditation, ओम एज एन एड फॉर मेडिटेशन, एड हियर इज आलंबना, और ओम इफ इट इज टेकन एज परम ब्रह्म इट इज ऑल्सो एन एड फॉर गेनिंग ज्ञानम. हाउ? बाय स्टडीइंग द मांडुक्य उपनिषद, बाय स्टडीइंग अबाउट वॉट दिस ओम रियली means and how this Omkara has been loaded with all these wonderful imagery of the waker and the waking jagat, the waking world, the sleeper and the jagat in repose, resolved jagat, and then the dreamer, Hiranyagarbha, the jagat in its potential, the knowledge potential, all this from the standpoint of the individual. This Omkara is taught to be everything. It is you, it is the world that you relate with, it is you in all three periods of time that you know intimately, no one else knows, your sleep, your dream, your waking. You are as though waking when in Vedanta class. And so all this you alone know intimately, no one else knows, correct? And so all this from your own experiences. Who says we don't talk about experience? It's all your own experience. Your own experience is magnified. This is micro, your own experience. And your own experience did not drop from the sky. Because if you look at all sleeping beings, you know, everyone looks innocent while they are sleeping, you know. Even the serial, you know, what is that, killer. If you see them all disarmed and sleeping, they look like babies, correct? Why? Because they have become Ishwarized for the time that they are sleeping. There is no duality. They don't hate the world. Even the most stressful person who's got the forehead in knots, you know, while sleeping looks very relaxed. Looks like Vishnu, Mahavishnu, lying down on the Sili posturpedic coiled mattress. This is what it is. So this is way, you know, there is, you see that your experiences suddenly have not dropped down from the sky. Your experiences are part of everyone's experiences. So you are sleeping and the, you know, neighbor is sleeping, the king is sleeping, the common person is sleeping. In sleep, everything is leveled. You see that. And one person is waking and running around saying, I have to go to work. You know, I have to sell a car, otherwise my job will be lost. Used car salesperson. And and then the other one says, today I have to buy a car, otherwise I won't be able to go to work, my car has gone. And somehow the two meet, you see. And both go away happy. The one who buys says, I really got a good deal. And the one who sells says, oh, that man is such a, you know, so naive. He just, you know, paid thousands of dollars extra for this just wheels and a steering wheel, just that it was, with a shell on top, it was nothing really. And both of them are happy. You see, there is some kind of, you see, you cannot but recognize the karmic connection between the seller and the buyer. Here both of them stressed, if I don't sell, I lose my job today. If I don't buy the car, I can't go to work today. And suddenly, they are together, they shake hands on the deal, and you know, he's able to drive out of the lot, Bhagavan's grace. And so this is how it is. This whole way, even in the waking world, there are patterns that you see, that your experiences are not being had in some vacuum, in like a flask, you know, like a vacuum flask. Only you are there with your own world and your own experiences, even though in the West people have started to live that way. Oh, I'm a private person and I don't want to do this, I don't want to answer the phone because I'm a private person. I don't want to open the door because I'm a private person. Then what? I just need therapist, that's all. You know, because suddenly I'm lonely. Because I'm not opening the door and I'm not answering the phone. I'm not going out. I'm not letting other people come into my house either. So we think that we are living in a vacuum, but we are not. You know, our lived experiences in the waking state intimately impact and are connected to other people's lived experiences also in the waking state. So your waking state is not something like a pie that has dropped out of the sky. It is not unique. If you think it is unique, the Mandukya Upanishad has something else to offer. It says no. Everybody is awake, everybody brushes their teeth, and everybody does this, and everybody is stressed, everybody does this. So now not only are you the waker, but in this scenario of you being the waker, you are dragging along with you the entire waking world, because you impact this waking world, the waking world impacts you. So how are you separate? How can you be alienated? I better not give away too much of the Thanksgiving retreat. So, then what will I talk of for 4 days? So, anyway, so, you know, you are connected. You are connected to your world. You impact your world even by throwing garbage. You are still impacting the world in a very big way. So, nobody needs to feel that I have not done anything fulfilling. Why? Because I have contributed to a landfill, you know, in my life. So that at least that we can take away. So there is so much there connected. And even the dreaming world, and everybody writes down their dreams and then discusses the dreams over tea with a significant other. And then, you know, in these dreams, they keep a journal of the dreams. This is my dream. And you ask other people their dream, they same dream. Same dream. It just shows that there is an overflow of the waking state that has carried over in terms of memories, fears and desires. It has bloomed into the dream state. And the dream state again is not happening in the vacuum. In two senses, not only is your own dream state, you know, it's not that it's unique to you. It's happening to others, number one. Number two, it is also, there is a kind of a macro corollary here in the state of the Jagat yet to be born. When Ishvara is pregnant with the thought of the Jagat, and the thought itself brings forth, but just that pre-thought, you know, there is no time because time is yet to come. That pre-thought stage, that itself is just like the dream. Everything is being visualized. Nothing is here yet. It's like a lucid dream. So here, where is the disconnection? And where is, you know, you are included in everything. Oh, but is this all? No. This is not all. There is more. Oh, there is more? Yes, there is more. What more is there? Then what happens? You know? What happens, when we say Om, each, waking state, waker, waking state, waking world. Ooh. What is who? Dreamer, dream state, dream world. Sleeper, sleep state, sleep world. Oh, is this all there is? What am I then? Am I the waker? No. Am I the waking world? No. Am I the dreamer? No. Am I the dreaming world? No. Am I the sleeper, sleeping world? No. What are you? You are that. You are equal to that, which is symbolized by the silence at the end of one Om and at the beginning of the other. You are not silence. You are equal to that which is symbolized by the silence. That's why it is called Amatra, because it has no Matra. Because the Matra means you have, it has to have Uccharana Shakti. Correct? Uccharana means the enunciation Shakti should be there. That's why it is Matra. Ooh, Matra. Ooh, two matras. Ooh, three matras. How many matras? That was silence. How many matras? Oh, I was silent for 5 matras. You can't do that. Silence which cannot be pronounced you know, if it's not pronounceable, it cannot have a unit of measurement. This is what is the brilliant thing about this silence. It is beyond the unit of measurement that by which pronunciation is judged. That's why it is called amatra. And this amatra, beyond the unit of measurement, paradoxically, it upholds all units of measurements without being any one of them. It is amatra, but because of it, matras can be counted. Ooh, you see? If I say, ooh, ooh, first one matra, correct? And then? Two. How do we know? Because in between the first matra and then the other two matras, what is there? Silence. And that silence is what is allowing you to hear that this one is one and this one is two. Otherwise, you would keep saying, ooh. That makes no sense. Ooh, ooh. Immediately it makes sense. And that small, that split of that silence, we don't even think about it. We don't notice it. It's not even there as far as our daily encounters are concerned. But without that, there is nothing. Just like silence upholds speech, punctuates speech, and becomes that out of which speech emerges, by which speech is sustained and unto which speech is resolved. Brahman is like that silence from which everything arises, by which everything is sustained, unto which everything resolves. So this Parambrahma is amatra, you know. It measures time for everything, itself timeless. It parcels out spaces for everything to occupy different things, but itself is free of space, free of time, free of all, you know, measurements, all limitations, free of being any particular object. Deshataha, kalataha, vastutaha, aparichinnatvam means not limited by time, space or object. This is the knowledge and this is the alambana, even though it's not technically alambana. Alambana means that upon which I rely to get to something, a crutch. So this is the crutch for the jnani, want to be. The one who wants to be a jnani has to look at Omkara from this standpoint that we just talked about. To look at oneself as connected to everything. And all this, everything resolves into this I. I don't resolve into anything. This is what is understood. That I means Satyam Jnanam Anantam Satchid Ananda. In short, Om. This is what the whole thing is. Very beautiful. So therefore, Etad Hi Eva Alam Etad Alambanam Shreshtam. Shreshtha. It's a very interesting word. Ishtan, Ishtan, you know, Shreyas and Shreshtha. Iyasun and Ishtan are the pratyayas, comparative and superlative. The word is not Shrey, it is actually Prashasya. Prashasya, Shraha, there is one sutra. Replace the word Prashas by Shraha. So it becomes Shreshtha. Shreyas. Shra plus yes, Shreyas. Shra plus Ishtan, Ishta, Shreshtha. That's how the word is derived. Actually, it is Prashasya. Yeah, so the word is Prashasya, but there is a replacement. Replace the whole word with Shra. Paninian Sutra is there. That's how this word is coming. So, Etad Alambanam Shreshtham. Shreshtham means the most exalted, the purest of the alambanas. So there may be many alambanas, many ways of meditating, many objects to center the mind, whether even a candle is an alambana. You know, you practice looking at the candle, it's called, what is that called? Trataka. You keep staring at the candle, 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 candle. You shouldn't blink. And then after that, you close your eyes, you have to recall the candle and keep holding on to that candle in the closed eye. Then after it goes away, then you open the eye and stare at the candle. This is a meditation practice. Yoga, yoga marga people do that. Hatha yogis do that. And then, you know, so the candle becomes here, alambana. You see what I'm saying? Because that's what you're focusing on. And not that you're interested in the candle. You're interested in practicing mind centering and the ability to hold on to a particular image. So candle becomes the pratima over which the alambana is centered. Here om becomes the pratika over which the alambana, the meditation, is centered. And he says there may be many meditation, you know, centric practices where you focus on candle. Sometimes you sort of blur your eyes and look at the tree, and sometimes you're asked to, you know, visualize white light, yellow light, green light, blue light, rainbow light, whatever it is, in between the eyebrows. Sometimes you're asked to hear sounds. That is dangerous. But anyway, so this is what, and sometimes you do these pranayamas. There is one called Bhramari. Bhramari means you make a noise like a bee. It's actually quite nice. You know, don't say om. It's just till everything becomes you become a walking capital M, you know. There's Bhramari. And then there is Shito Paladi. You curl your tongue like this. If you have a cold, you do this, it will go in 2 days. It's very effective. Try.
How long do you do that?
I don't know. You'll have to look it up. You can Google it and find out. And Anuloma Viloma Pranayama. You know. So now we are talking of pratikas, noises. Okay. So various, that's why I'm focused here. So so you make this this sibilant inhalation sound, and it's very good for colds. Even though it's bringing in cold air, somehow it helps, you know, with the cold. And so then there is all other kinds of noises you can make. You say, oh, you know, Shiva, and or sometimes you go in for these TM type meditations where there is no deity per se, but they give these bija mantras. Transcendental meditation gives just hreem, 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 hreem. You keep hreeming all day, aiming all day, shreeming all day, not screaming, shreeming all day. And you know, there is so many sounds you can focus on. Etad alambanam shreshtam. This om is better than all of them put together. Humming, zzz, all these, you know, pranayama sounds, bija sounds, other sounds. Heavy metal music sounds. Sometimes people use that for meditation. Teenagers usually. And so this is Shrestha. This is better, not better, best among all of them. Yeah. Shreyas means better. Shrestha means best. Why is Shreyas better? Because it's always seen in connection with prayers. That's why. Even though it's also the best, you know, but still, because it's always seen in connection with prayers, we say better. Where have we heard Shreyas prayers? Mundaka Upanishad. Yeah? This one only? Sure? Abba. Okay. So this is Shreshtha. Eta Dalambanam Shreshtham. This is the best way. For what? For gaining Brahman. Which Brahman? Whichever Brahman you are ready for. He's going to say this at the end. Up till now he was polite, he didn't bring in adhikaritvam, he's going to bring it in now. Whichever Brahman, whosoever is ready for, they will get that using this as an aid for meditation or as an aid for knowledge. Same rules which we discussed earlier apply to the first and the second quarter of this mantra also. Etad devalambanam shreshtam for aparam brahma, etad devalambanam param for param brahma. And then etad alambanam jnatva, gaining this knowledge. So first is one person is using this meditation to relate to Ishvara. Okay. Then another person, an ideal type person in a scenario, is using this to go to Brahmaloka. Using this for Punya to reach Brahman, so to speak. Correct? Because that's what they think Nirguna Upasana is. So they are going to Brahmaloka. So okay, they will go there. But really speaking, the best one is the third one, the one who knows the meaning of this Om and understands it and internalizes the knowledge as the truth of oneself. Etad alambanam jnatva. What happens? Brahmaloke mahiyate. Mahiyate means is adored, worshipped. Comes from Mahan, Mahiyate. Adored, worshipped greatly, adored, seen as adorable. Where? In Brahmaloka. And there are two meanings for Brahmaloka. So if you want to go to Brahmaloka through Omkara Upasana, so you can take it literally. So the person who has gone to Brahmaloka as the result of this meditation, using this Alambana Om, is worshipped in Brahmaloka. But here we can take Brahmaloka as Brahma Eva Lokaha. You know, Brahman is the Loka. That is Brahmaloka for who? The third kind of person described in the last line, in the first quarter of the last line. Brahma, who, what is that? Etad alambanam jnatva. The one who has studied this, understood this, and internalized this knowledge, that person gains Brahman as the Loka. Not Brahmaloka. But Brahman itself is the Loka for whom? Means gains everything. And then what? Brahmaloke mahiyate. That is the meaning. Let us see Bhashya. Actually, we'll take a quick 2-minute break and then come back and see Bhashya, okay?
Yeah.
I won't turn off anything because with great difficulty everything is just now turned on. Yeah. You tested again? Here it was not showing much difference, whether here or there, when you played it on there.
Yeah, but on the computer it was smooth.
Very good, very good. Yes.
He's down here. If they say anything about it being Tini Swamiji, you can...
How is the audio with the microphone? If anybody is still there?
In Adobe.
In Adobe? Oh, they have all gone away. Afterwards you ask. Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so when there is nothing to uphold, it is not Adhishthana.
Okay. So that's why we were saying, Nirguna, there is no Adhishthana, there is nothing.
No.
But then we say it's the one that upholds everything. Mm-hmm.
How do we say that?
Like when we say that silence is Nirguna, right?
Yeah.
That is the one we say that upholds.
Potentially, when there is speech.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, when there is speech, silence upholds everything.
Okay.
When there is no speech, what is there to uphold?
No speech,
Yes,
God.
What is there to uphold? or hold up. The mic is not going off at all. Refresh what to get back? Lose connection where? No, the mic is not going off at all for us. Yeah, you please check, because here it seems to be very steady. Again, after a lot of experimentation. यतः
यतः
एवमतः
एवमतः
एंड ही सेज यू नो परम चेत इन प्रीवियसली इट वाज सेड ज्ञातव्यम अपरम चेत प्राप्तव्यम यतः मींस बिकॉज़ सो फोर्थ मीनिंग नाउ वी विल सी व्हाई एतदालंबनम
एतदालंबनम
एतद्ब्रह्म
एतद्ब्रह्म
एतद् ब्रह्म प्राप्ति आलम्बनानां श्रेष्ठं प्रशस्यतमं प्रशस्यस्य प्रशस्य इज़ द वर्ड ही इज़ रिमाइंडिंग अस प्रशस्यतमं ही इज़ यूजिंग यू नो तमप इंस्टेड ऑफ इष्ठन् सो एतद् आलंबनम एतद् ब्रह्म प्राप्ति आलंबनानां सो ऑफ ऑल द वेज एंड मीन्स टू अक्वायर ब्रह्मन यू नो बोथ द फोनी वंस एंड द ऑथेंटिक वंस वन मे ऐड दिस इज द बेस्ट वी हैव ऑलरेडी सीन व्हाई व्हाई बिकॉज ऑफ द प्रतीक बिकॉज इट इज वी सॉ हाउ वी सीन ऑल दैट It's easy to pronounce, it is universal, it includes I, it includes everything. That's why it is the best for this. It's a best Omkara if you look at it as an aid for meditation and as an aid for gaining Brahman. It is the best, you know, Alambana, it's the best aid. Etad Alambanam.
Etad Alambanam.
Param Aparam Cha. Yeah, so here he says the subject matter of Omkara is both Param and Aparam Brahma. Simple. This is what? This is the subject matter of Omkara is Param Brahma and Aparam Brahma. So this is for both, gaining both. Para para. Brahma Vishayatvat.
Brahma Vishayatvat.
How can you say it is a aid for both, you know, gaining Param Brahma and Aparam Brahma? Aparam Brahma is what? Ishvara. Param Brahma is you. How is this both? How can I do both with one stroke? How is this? Because the word Om is loaded with the subject matter of both apara and para in there. Because when you say Om, you are counting the non-pronounceable fourth matra, amatra. That amatra you are counting. Because when you say Om, there are three overt things and then one covert thing which is indicated, which is not explaining that thing, but which is indicating to that thing. The overt things are tatastha lakshana, you know, they are there, and they are there to be seen. Like the jagat can be objectified, and the covert one is swarupa lakshana, it is indeed you. So the subject matter of the word Om has been loaded with both the overt and the covert aspects of Bhagavan. Covert means non-objectifiable and objectifiable aspects of Bhagavan. I mean, even if it is, you know, even if it is not understood as I, it is understood as Bhagavan. So both those things being the subject matter of Om, this is why this Adi Shankara says, you can say this Alambanam is for Param as well as Aparam.
Etadalambanam
jnatva
brahmaloke mahiyate
parasmin brahmani
aparasmin cha
brahmabhutah
brahmavad upasyo bhavati
ityarthah.
Yeah, so he says very simple, very straightforward, shloka, and he says that etad alambanam jnatva. Jnatva also includes upasya, because already it was talked about earlier on this page. Jnatva, upasya, he says. So, whether jnatva, if the person has the capacity to understand, jnatva, if the person just does upasana, upasya, having done upasana or having understood brahmaloke mahiyate, and he immediately says brahmaloka is not a place other than this, it is parasmin brahmani mahiyate, is adored in as Brahman, is adored, it's not a particular loka, is adorable in his or her own nature, is adorable just because the person is a knowledgeable person, has no longer the self-ignorance, so therefore it is such a person mahiyate. And he also says aparasmin cha, so even in if you take it to be a loka, not parasmin brahmani, aparasmin brahmani cha mahiyate means also is worshipped as Bhagavan, not as a, let's say, a knowledgeable person who but is worshipped as upasya. The person becomes upasya for others, just like we worship Pujya Swamiji. Like that, the person is worshipped. Why? Brahmavid, Brahmaiva Bhavati. There is a Vakya. The person who knows Brahman is non-separate from Brahman, because one who knows Brahman is Brahman. Brahmavid, Brahmaiva Bhavati. And here he says, Brahmabhutah, Brahmavad Upasyo Bhavati. So the one who is, who gains Brahman in this life, what happens? What happens? Upasya bhavati becomes upasaniya, becomes an altar of surrender for other people interested in either worldly or spiritual gains. This is what even the Mundaka Upanishad also talks about. I want to look at how this Gambhirananda Swami translates this particular one. Yeah. Etadalambanam Shrestham. Now this part, that part is all okay. Jnatva, he says, meditating on Brahmaloke, one is worshipped. You can say in Brahmaloka, or you can say becomes adorable like Brahman. That was the whole thing. This is all to praise Omkara, and here we are not interested in all this Alambana, etc. We are interested in what the Om signifies. What is that? You, the knowledge, which is what Nachiketa asked for. So after these two slightly digressions, because he said, I will tell you this in brief, and then I will expound this Om. So he is going to expound this Om from verse number 18 onwards, and we'll chant the verse first. And then see the bhashya. Najayate mriyate va vipaschit.
Najayate mriyate va vipaschit.
Nayam kutaschinna babhuva kaschit.
Nayam kutaschinna babhuva kaschit.
Ajo nityashashvato yam puranah.
Ajo nityashashvato yam puranah.
Nahanyate hanyamane sharire.
Nahanyate hanyamane sharire.
Very nice. So, you know, this is where the teaching, you know, is taking off. Because from here to probably the end of this. No, till 22. Yeah, from here to 22 is the elucidation of the meaning of the word Om. What is this Om? Om as self-knowledge. What does this signify? And what does this mean? This is up till 22. And then from 23 onwards, 23 and 24, no, 23 is basically how, you know, it is gained. What is at stake in gaining this knowledge? And 24 is a warning to not give this knowledge to those that are not qualified, either through, you know, adhikaritvam or through because they are not dharmic, lack of shraddha, all these things. Don't give it to people like that. And the last one is a victory declaration from the standpoint of the one who has this knowledge, and how they will keep the death at bay. And then this whole section will conclude. So this is how the layout is. So very interesting. And even within the layout, the first one that I talked about, that from the 18th to 22, there is talk about this Atma. The Atma as Om is talked about. And 18 has a particular flavor. This is an important verse also in the Bhagavad Gita, with a slight difference. Bhagavad Gita has almost lifted it, verbatim, and except in Vipaschit is replaced by Kadachit. Na jayate mriyate va kadachit nayam. No, instead of Kadachit, yeah, it's slightly different. First two lines are different. The second two lines are verbatim. So, na jayate mriyate va kadachit nayam bhavita bhutva vana bhuyah. Yeah, so ajo nitya shashvato, those two are same. Yeah, so that's the first two lines are slightly different. And this talks about the nature of the Atma as being timeless and not subject to death. The second one, verse number 19, addresses kartritvam and bhoktritvam. Kartritva bhoktritva pratishedha, meaning the negation of doership and enjoyership. Doership and experiencership is negated in number 19. In number 18, sakshat swarupa nirdharanam. Meaning, what is that? Ascertaining the swarupa, the nature of the Atma as timeless. Verse number 19. Kartritva bhoktritva nishedha, negation of what? Doership for the Atma, for the I. Negation of Atma being the victim, Atma being the agent, not a possibility. And then verse number 20 is talking further, expounding the limitlessness of the Atma and what it takes to see this. And verse number 21 is talking about the contrary, the paradoxes of the Atma, that which is everywhere and yet also is in one body, that which is unmoving and yet is going everywhere. This is the one. 21 and 22 are talking about the contrary paradoxical attributes, so-called attributes of the Atma. And finally, 23 is talking about negating wrong notions connected to sadhana, and also talking about how to be kind to oneself. This is important in the quest of Atma, being extremely kind to oneself. So now that we have mapped out the rest of this chapter, let us look at this mantra. Na jayate. What is that? Very simple. He is not born. Na, and that na has to be carried over. You cannot say na jayate but mriyate. Mriyate means dies. There's only one thing which na jayate but mriyate. What is that?
Ignorance.
Na jayate but mriyate. Which one? Only self-ignorance. Na jayate is never born but dies. When? Now. Right now. Right now it's dying. It's saying, oh help, help, get me out of this class. No, no, no. Not this verse, please. But it's dying as we speak. Na jayate but mriyate. You know, mriyate va. Neither is born nor dies. And the Atma. The Atma is described here as Vipaschit. Vipaschit visheshena pashyati. Yeah. Visheshena pashyati iti vipaschit. And vipaschit visheshena pashyati means sees something more than what is there to see. Like even a poet. You know, the average person will look at the falling leaves. That's why it's called fall, because it's a big fall. And says, oh my God, so much to do, I have to rake the yard again? How boring! But the poet sees so many things. He's not bothered about raking the yard. Sees the color, the beauty, the touch of Ishvara, and makes a poem which is a bridge to Ishvara, not only for the poet, but for other people also. It is a still evening, calm and free. The holy time is quiet as a nun. Wordsworth wrote, you know, so nice, beautiful. So like this you have so many poems. And so the poet is usually called a vipaschit, kavihi, duradarshi. You know, someone who sees a little more than what other people see. Generally that is vipaschit. And here vipaschit means the all-seeing medhavi atma. Medhavi here means all-knowing is all-seeing. Not that atma has a pair of eyes, it doesn't even have a single eye, yet it sees everything. It knows everything. This all-knowing Atma is neither subject to birth nor subject to what? Death. Death and birth are knocked off. So we have six vikaras, correct? Anytime, this is the trick to this internalizing this pedagogy of the teaching. Anytime you come across either birth or death, or come across both those two together, both of them together, you immediately think of the six modifications. What are they? Jayate, born. Asti. Asti means what?
Survives
birth, which is a big thing. And then? Vardhate. You know, vardhate means grows up. Viparinamate, blossoms, becomes capable of reproduction. Oh, that sounds wonderful. Well, next one. Apak plus kshi, apakshiyate. You know, apakshiyate, kshayati. And then? Ram naam satya hai, you know. Vinashyati, six. So Vinashyati is mriyate, correct? Jayate. So the bookends are gone. That means what? The Atma vardhate, viparinamate and apakshiyate, correct? Yes?
No.
Are you just following them or are you saying something else?
No.
No, okay. then why no? Because if it's not even born, how can it grow up? And if it's not subject to death, how can it decline? So if you knock off the two bookends, this is anyaya. If you knock off the two bookends, the book holders, and all the books are also not there. The books which are what? A tree dies on birth, death, decimation, etc. All those books also disappear, correct? Mm-hmm. Yeah. They all disappear because these two, the main things have been knocked. This, you know, this is a very nice nyaya. So, Prathama Malla Nyaya. Malla is a village wrestler. A wrestler in the village, champion. He has oiled his biceps and triceps and six pack. And he is wandering around in the, where? In the village square. Why? Because he is the declared champion. He has biffed out of the competition all and pounded the other wrestlers out of the competition. In fact, if they have to go shopping, they wear a veil and go, the other wrestlers, because they don't want to see him and make eye contact. They cross-dress and go to the market because they are so afraid of this fellow. So if you want to be the reigning champion, do you have to pick a fight with every street urchin and biff them? No. You just deal with this malla, correct? Yeah. You take the malla out of the competition by biffing him out of the competition, and then you become the next malla, correct? This Atma is a big malla. This is called Prathama Malla Nyaya. The logic of Prathama here doesn't mean first, the best, the champion wrestler. The champion wrestler here is what? Birth and death. These two are the champions. They hold everyone in their thrall, and they are the ones who everybody shakes. Not so much birth, but yes, even that's traumatic. And then death, of course. And death means another rebirth. Oh my God. So when this one is knocked out and negated completely, what to do with their children? Vardhate, asti, viparinamate, apakshiyate. Fate, gone. They are nothing to be even talked about. They don't even exist. Gone. You just get up, dust yourself, and you know, go your merry way. So this Atma vipaschit has knocked off birth and death for itself. No more is there birth and death. This Atma, this all-seeing, all-knowing, uncreated, indestructible Atma ityarthaha has knocked off birth and death for itself. Na ayam kutaschit. Na ayam kutaschit means it is not born out of any cause. The Atma is not because of any cause. It is just the cause. When it is as seen as Ishvara, and when there is a Jagat to account for. So there is no cause. There is no cause for Atma. What is the Dada of the Atma? If you have if you go on genealogy.com, ancestry.com, and you get some free space. This is what I have heard. I've never gone. And you write Atma, last name Brahman, and Atman Brahman, formal names. And then you try to look for the descendants. No descendants. Then you try to look for the ascendants. You know, people who have gone before. What is the genie? Who is the Brahman's father? No father. Who is Brahman's mother? No mother. Because na jayate. If it is not born, how does it have a parent? How does it have a cause? If it's not born, it is causeless. This is kind of hard to understand, but that's what it is. It is causeless. It's not caused at all. Na ayam kutashchita. It has not come from anywhere. From nowhere has it come. And then what? You know, not only has it not been born out of any cause, and it has also not changed into something else. Na babhuva kashchita. It has not become something else. Oh, but this is a lie. It has become the Jagat. Has it become the Jagat? As though. Everywhere you add an as though. This is the, you know, attorney for the Atma. This is the loophole. As though. Then you can say anything. You say as though. As though has lent its presence, because everything that comes is mithya. Just like you sustain your dream, Atma has lent its presence to this entire universe of names and forms. Names and forms are subject to birth and death. Atma withdraws at the last minute and then lets them go on their merry way. Atma does not die even when the form dies. That's what it is. Because it's indestructible, najayate namriyate, kadachit, at any time, vipaschit, you know, this all-seeing Atma, na ayam kutaschit, not only has it not come from anywhere, and not only does it not have a cause, na babhuva kaschit, it has also not become anything else other than itself. So the first two lines, it is through the Neti Neti program of Vedanta graduate program. This is the Neti Neti 201, correct? Because it's everywhere there is a na na na, do you see? Where? Na jayate, na mriyate, and then?
Na ayam
kaschit. Na ayam kutaschit, na babhuva kaschit, four nas. And one more you can bring in when you know, add the anuvritti. So many nas, 3 plus 1, 4 nas are there. So already a thing is, you know, a kind of a idea is forming about the Atma in the head of the reader.
Uh-huh.
Namely?
Not this.
Yeah, namely what? What is this that is being, you know, talked about? Atma is not born. Does not die. It doesn't have a cause. Doesn't have an effect. Therefore it is what? Zero. Shunya. This neti neti teaching has to be followed by iti iti teaching. Otherwise it goes into shunyatvam. And I mean it. Shunyaha. You are shunya. That's why it's called shunyatvam. You are shunya. That is where it goes. I am zero. Here I thought at least I was famous, you know, in my own house I was famous. At least my dog thought I was famous because it knew me. And it had introduced me to all the other neighborhood dogs. So at least in my house I thought I was famous. But here I'm recognizing that I'm nothing. I'm, after coming to Vedanta, not only I'm not famous, I'm a big zero. I don't even exist. Because if something is not born, if something doesn't die, if something cannot die, and if something was not caused by something else, and if something did not, you know, transmute into or form into something else, then what is the guarantee that it exists? Atma is a big zero. Now to negate that, we have affirmation sentences, what exactly it is. The teaching happens through negation. But then we have to come back to understand what is that thing Atma really is, you know. So it says ajaha. Yeah, even that's slightly negation, but we'll come back to that. Na jayate iti ajaha, ever unborn. Ajaha, not caused. Nityaha, that one does it. Nityaha means always there in the same form without undergoing any change whatsoever. Nityaha, shashvataha, ever fresh, ever new. Puranaha, was always there before, and pura eva navacha, he will explain all that. Ayam means this one. And then what? The beautiful line at the end, is not destroyed when this body is destroyed, When the body is destroyed, Atma is not destroyed. Cannot be. Very beautiful, because the teaching is now coming directly to the person studying. That is, here Nachiketa is being told that just because the body is destroyed doesn't mean Atma is destroyed. Because the Atma is as though inhabiting the body-mind-sense complex, and if the body is destroyed, it just joins everything as it is, because it has no effect, it's not afflicted in any way at all. So there is a small Sangati Bhashya. Sangati means a connection. And the connection between the last verse and this mantra, and we will see that.
Anyatra dharmad
ityadina
prishtasya
atmanah
ashesha
vishesha
rahitasya
rahitasya
alambanatvena
pratikatvena cha
omkarah
nirdishtah.
Yeah.
Anyatra dharmad ityadina prishtasya. That question which started with anyatra dharmad. What was that? Nachiketa's third request, third boon request, which was what? I want that which is other than dharma, other than adharma, other than papa, punya, everything. That is what I want. Prishtasya. So for that which was asked by Nachiketa, you know, and for that question which was asked by Nachiketa, Atmanah ashesha vishesha rahitasya. So for what was that question centered on? The question was centered on Atma, which is free of all attributes. Ashesha vishesha rahitah. You know, because it is free of all attributes. So that Atma which is free of all attributes became the subject matter, which became the subject matter of Nachiketa's third question, in starting with Anyatra Dharmat, etc. And that was responded to in the form of Alambana and Pratika of the Omkara, in the form of the teaching, Nirdishtah. This plus this, dish. Dish becomes Dishtah. Dish to teach, the Adarsha, not this one. Yeah, because it becomes Dishtah in PPP, past passive participle. So, Nirdishtah. Alambanatvena cha Nirdishtah. Pratikatvena cha Nirdishtah. So, it was taught in the form of something that that talks about Brahman, that just immediately brings Bhagavan to mind. And it was also talked as an aid for meditation, an aid for gaining the knowledge of Brahman also. Correct?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So here, Alambanatvena, Pratikatvena, both are in Ittham Bhute Tritiya, in the form of, not by or which, but in the form of Alambana it was taught, in the form of Pratika it was taught. It's a certain kind of a, you know, jatabhihi tapasaha means what? How do you recognize a tapasvi?
Mm-hmm.
By the jata, jatabhihi. It's not, you know, through the jata, in the form of the jata is walking the sadhu. This is how you say, you know, the one who is giving jatabhihi tapasaha dandena vriddhaha, like this. So with the stick, with the help of the stick, you recognize the elderly person. So like that, this is the kind of a you know, oftly used third case to translate in the form of. So this Omkara teaching was given in the form of Alambana, meaning as an aid in the previous verse, and as a Pratika in the verse before that. It was already given. Aparasya cha
brahmanah
manda madhyama pratipatrun
prati.
Yeah. So it was taught, not only that, and then it was it was taught To whom was it taught? This aparam aparasya cha brahmanah. So this the param brahma was also talked about, but this alambana and pratika was for gaining aparam brahma. Aparam brahma here means Ishvara, to gain Ishvara's grace, to gain antakkarana shuddhi, all those things. Who was it taught to? You know, manda madhyama pratipatrun. What is pratipatrun? Which case? 2-3, very good. 2-3, very very good. Yeah, neta netarau netarah netaram netarau netrun. Correct? Uh-huh. 2-3, pratipatrun, pratipatru. The pratipatta means the one who is the agent of the pratipatti, the knower, the potential knower here. So which knower? The manda knower and the madhyama knower. The manda knower will see Om as a crutch to gain some goodies from Ishvara or to go to Ishvara. The madhyama knower will see aparam brahma as Omkara, as a means to go to Brahma Loka perhaps. So this was taught for the manda adhikari and the madhyama adhikari. And why do they need this teaching? So that they can qualify for what is coming now. Na jayate mriyate va, otherwise how will they understand? And so the teaching has to be like that. Even though Nachiketa is not a manda madhyama adhikari, it is given everything so that there is no doubt at all what this Om means. So it's given in the short form so that whoever is not qualified can qualify, and then the teaching starts. So manda madhyama pratipatrun prati, it was given. Prati means towards them it was directed. These two were directed towards the manda madhyama adhikaris. Atha idanim idanim tasya omkara
आलंबनस्य
आत्मनः
साक्षात्स्वरूप
निर्धारयिषया इदमुच्यते. So having made short shrift of the manda and the madhyama adhikaris, of the slightly qualified and the not yet qualified, what? Adhikaris, the people for this knowledge. Now, atha idanim, now this, you know, this omkara, how to use it as an aid for knowledge, and what does that knowledge look like, is being, you know, is being expounded. Tasya omkara alambanasya atmana sakshat swarupa nirdharayishaya, meaning in order to ascertain, with the desire to ascertain the true nature of this atma, to, and what is not said is towards the uttama adhikaris. Who are they? Everyone here, because we are studying this, towards the best of the adhikaris. And so this is being idam uchyate, this is being talked about. Very nice word here. Nirdharitum icha nirdharisha. And then to that the word tritiya is added. Nirdharitum ichaya nirdhara ishaya. What?
Nirdhari, it's doubled.
Oh, that's right, yeah. Nirdhara ishaya, correct, yes. Nirdhara ishaya. So, dharitum, dharaitum, icha. It's a desiderative. So, it is desire to ascertain. So, and then that, to that, you know, it's put in third case, that, you know, with the view, with the desire to ascertain the true nature of the Atma as an alambana, as a way to gain the one's own swarupa, an insight into one's own swarupa, this is being said. What is being said? न जायते म्रियते वा विपश्चित इत्यादिना दैट वी विल सी दैट वी विल सी नेक्स्ट वीक वेरी नाइस ओम पूर्णमदः पूर्णमिदं पूर्णात् पूर्णमुदच्यते पूर्णस्य पूर्णमादाय पूर्णमेवावशिष्यते ओम शांति शांति शांतिः हरिः ओम श्री गुरुभ्यो नमः हरिः ओम
Today was marathon. Mm-hmm. Very quickly we went. Mm-hmm. Lots of bhashya was done. Okay.